Okay, everyone, welcome. Welcome to the Torah studies this week, Parshas Re'eh. This Shabbos is going to be a very special Shabbos. We're going to bless the new month, the month of Elul, the month, last month of the year. We're going to start blowing the shofar. We're getting ready. Yes, it's coming. And the topic today we're discussing is Jerusalem, our eternal, undivided capital. I know this is a topic that a lot in the news. Jewish people always have their heart in Jerusalem. Sometimes you don't even realize how much we pray, we talk constantly. Think about it. Every day you're saying three times a day, "Vnei Yerushalayim, build Yerushalayim." Saying you're having the Seder every year, Lashana Abab Yerushalayim. Not only that, when you eat food, you say the blessing after the food. Every time you eat a meal, whether it's a meal with bread or it's a meal with a cookie, you say, asking Hashem about Yerushalayim, thanking Hashem for giving us Yerushalayim, and so on. So, of course, today it's a very hot political issue, international. 1967, some of you are too young to remember that. Some of you do remember 1967. I happen to be too young to remember, but I happen to be born right there and right then, a few days before the war. I was born in Jerusalem. You know, of course, the Six-Day War, when a number of Arab countries surrounded and they threatened to wipe off Israel off the face of the earth, God forbid. And miraculously, in the war that took 6 days, they took over in the south from Egypt, they took over the Sinai Peninsula, in the north, the Golan Heights from the Syrians, and the Jordanians, they were in control of Jerusalem and the Judeans, parts of Judea and Samaria, what they call the West Bank of the Jordan River that was taken after Jordan insisted to join to this war. And again, with miracles, miracles upon miracles, that city was freed. And this was after 19 years since the 1948 war, when they lost the old city. No Jew was allowed to go and pray by our holiest site, the Western Wall, the place, the site of the Holy of Holies, the temple. And my bris happened to be on the day that they conquered Jerusalem, just about a mile and a half away from Jerusalem, from the place on the Western Wall. That's where my bris took place. They hardly got a minyan. The Moel, Olav HaShalom, he told me that there was, you know, he was running between the shells, hiding from the shells that were flying. And we had this great miracle of freeing Yerushalayim. It was the pouring out of emotions when they came. And they said, the Har HaBayit B'yadeinu, they came down to the Western Wall. Soldiers that came from backgrounds, totally unreligious, non-religious, secular, atheists, they came to and they saw, they stood there by the wall, they were crying like babies. So tonight, we're going to discuss this. What is so special about Yerushalayim? Why are we so emotionally attached, connected to Jerusalem? And of course, we know we're connected to Jerusalem because of the Holy Temple that stood there. But it's much, there is much more to it, as we'll see. Because the temple, although both temples, the first temple, the second temple, stood in Jerusalem, but this was not the first place where Jews had a temple. And that's the question is, what is so special about Jerusalem? That's what we're going to discuss today. Just a second. All right. On June 20th of June 1967, the Israeli government announced an official reunification of Jerusalem would take place on the following morning. And some people feared that too swift of an opening of 19-year-old barriers would lead to tensions and violence. But the Minister of Defense, Moshe Dayan, was emphatic that there would be no hesitation and no delays. Dawn came, and we did it. Teddy Kollek later wrote, he was the mayor of Jerusalem so many years, I remember him. And he said, we removed all defenses, dismantled all the checkposts, and started blowing up all the dividing walls. Jerusalem was once again a physical unity, a single city. And the question is, why? What is so special about Jerusalem? Why do we feel so strongly about Jerusalem? What is so special about this piece of real estate? So that's what we're going to talk about tonight, to learn about the spiritual center, that Jerusalem is the spiritual center and the eternal capital of Israel. Now, as I mentioned before, we say Jerusalem is so special. Why? Because of the temple. Before the temple came to Jerusalem, was a number of places that the temple stood. And this is a quote from the Maimonides. The Torah already specified that the tabernacle built by Moses was only temporary. As the passage states, for you have yet to arrive. That's from this Torah portion. And as soon as they entered Israel, they erected the tabernacle in Gilgal for 14 years, during which time they conquered and divided the land. There's a little dispute where exactly Gilgal is, but this was Joshua, when he came in with the Jewish people, they erected a tabernacle there. And for 14 years, it took them 14 years to divide, to conquer the whole land and to divide it to the different tribes. That's where the temple stood. And then, after the Gilgal, continues the Maimonides and says, from there, they came to Shiloh. And where they built a stone house without a roof. They built a stone house, which was, that was already more permanent, but it had no roof. It was covered instead with a covering used in the tabernacle. And this stood for 369 years. So 369 years, they had a temple in the place called Shiloh. That's a place north of Jerusalem. And not too many people are aware of that. Of course, if you know the history, you know. And then what happened? When Eli, the high priest, passed away, Shiloh was destroyed. It was destroyed by the Philistines. And the Jews came to Nob and built a temple there. When the prophet Samuel passed away, this too was destroyed, and they came to Givon, where they built a new temple. And from Givon, they came to the eternal home in Jerusalem. And the temple was in Nov and Givon for 57 years. So it turns out like this. So they had a temple. The first tabernacle was in the desert. That's where the holy ark was. And that took place in the year 1312 BCE. They entered the land of Israel in the year 1273 BCE. And that's where they built the temple in Gilgal for 14 years. In the year 1259 BCE, they came to Shiloh. And they stood there for 369 years. In the year 890 BCE, they had the temple in Nov and Givon. And finally, they came to Jerusalem, where King David came and his son, King Solomon, he built the first temple in the year 830 BCE and stood there for 410 years. It was destroyed. 70 years, the Jews were in exile, and they came back after 70 years in the year 350 BCE. They built the second temple, and that stood for 420 years until the year 70 of the Common Era. And that's when the second temple was destroyed. And we are waiting now for the third temple. The third temple will be built in Yerushalayim in the same place with the coming of Mashiach very soon, amen. And our sages tell us that this will be a temple that will never be destroyed. It will be the eternal temple. Now, we mentioned the different places where the temple stood, but there is something special about these two places, the place of Shiloh and Jerusalem. Shiloh and Jerusalem had exclusive status. What was the exclusive status? It was before there was a temple. Before they had a Mishkan, the tabernacle, people would be allowed to bring offerings to God on their own in the backyard. When the temple was built, they were only allowed to bring offerings in the temple. But this was only true in the Mishkan, and then which was in the tabernacle during the time of the desert. But then in Israel, in the land of Israel, it was only true in these two places. When the temple was in Shiloh, no one was allowed to bring an offering in the backyard. They had to bring it if they wanted to bring an offering to God. They had to come to the place, the temple in Shiloh. And the same thing was true in the temple in Jerusalem. But in the other places, when the temple was in the Gilgal, when the temple was in Nov and Givon between Shiloh and Jerusalem, they were allowed to bring offerings in their own private places as well. That was exclusive about these two places. As it says, brought down in the Sifri, it says, until they came to Shiloh, private altars were permitted. Once they came to Shiloh, private altars were banned. When they arrived in Nov and Givon, private altars were reinstituted. And when they arrived in Jerusalem, then private altars were permanently banned. Once the temple was built in Jerusalem, they were not allowed to bring any offerings outside of Jerusalem. And why is that? What was so special about these two places, Shiloh and Jerusalem, that when you had these places, they were not allowed to bring offerings anywhere else? What is unique about these two places is that these two places were places that God chose. Since God chose those places to bring the offerings, you couldn't bring it anywhere else. As we read in today's portion, it says, you must eat the tithings of your crops, wine and oil, as well as the firstborn of your cattle and sheep before God, your God, in the location of his choosing. So where was the location of his choosing? So like we said, it was Jerusalem and Shiloh. And that raises the question, if that is the case, if Jerusalem and Shiloh are considered the place of choice, how come we are stuck so with Jerusalem? Why don't we get Shiloh, the place of Shiloh, get this place as your chosen place? Wouldn't that be a compromise to get, to solve some political problems, perhaps? Of course, we're not serious about it, but we need to understand why. We need to understand why. If Shiloh was also a place of God's choosing, and how come it is only Jerusalem that we insist to be our place, our home forever? Why doesn't Shiloh resonate with Jews around the world as much as Jerusalem does? So, to understand this, we need to go back in history. We need to go back in history and understand that Jerusalem is much more than just the fact that the temple was built there. Jerusalem was actually the place in the time of Abraham, the time of Isaac, the time of Jacob, and even before. From the time of creation, it was the place. Everybody knew that this was something special about this place, about the place of Jerusalem, the Temple Mount. What was so special? So one of the places in the Torah, we know the story in the Torah, it says that when Abraham, he heard that his nephew Lot was kidnapped, was captured. He went and he fought a war and he conquered four kings and he freed his nephew Lot. And then the Torah says that the king of Shalem came out to greet him and invited him for a meal. Who was the king of Shalem? It was Shem, the son of Noah. Shem, which we are all called the Semites because of Shem. He was a righteous, holy man, and he was the king of Shalem. What is Shalem? Shalem is Jerusalem. Is that Nachmanides explains? Shalem is Jerusalem, as the psalmist wrote, says in the Tehillim, his tabernacle was in Shalem. From time immemorial, the nations knew that this was the preeminent location situated as the center of the inhabited world. It is possible, says the Nachmanides, that they were also aware of the cosmic significance of this location. It is located directly under the celestial sanctuary where God's presence is manifest. Our sages tell us that this was the place where Adam brought an offering. Cain and Abel brought the offering right there on the Temple Mount. That was the place that Adam was created from. The earth that God took to create Adam was from that location, from the altar, the place where the altar was. That's how Adam knew. And that's how his children knew. And it went on from generation to generation. They knew the specialty of this place. How did Adam know Jerusalem was Shalem, the perfect city? The clay from which Adam was formed was the clay of the Temple Mount. He first became conscious on this mountain. The first sight his eyes ever beheld was Jerusalem. This was not a location he was prone to forget. And indeed, he gave it over to his children. And the Maimonides explains that this was the place for King David, the place where Noah brought the offering, as we see in the next text. There is a widely held tradition that the location where King David and Solomon erected the altar, the threshing floor that David purchased from Aravna, is where Abraham erected the altar upon which he bound Isaac. That's what Hashem said to him, Lech lecha le'eretz Amoriah, go to the land that I will show you. The land of Amoriah, and that was that mountain. This is where Noah built his altar after emerging from the ark. This is where Cain and Abel build their altars for their respective offerings to God. Adam built an altar there and brought an offering to God when he was created. Our sages proclaimed, Adam was created on the very spot he received atonement. So they knew all along what was special about this place. All generations knew about this place. And why was this place indeed chosen? No, another story, the story of Yaakov, our father Jacob. When our father Jacob traveled to build his family to Haran, he was sent by his parents after running away from his brother Esav. He stopped in this place and he slept in that place. And he had this dream. And in his dream, he sees this ladder going, standing on the ground, and the head reaches the heaven. He dreamt, and behold, the ladder was set firmly on the ground, but its top reached the heavens. And behold, angels of God ascended and descended the ladder. This is why God chose this place. This is the place that God chose. It was a place when that was the nexus between the heaven and earth. The place where the angels going up and down, they ascend to bring up the prayers, they descend to bring down the blessings to the world. That is the place of Jerusalem, the place of the Holy Temple. So this location is the gateway to heaven. He was so overwhelmed by this epiphany, Yaakov, what he saw in the dream. He realized that this is the place. This is the location, the gateway to heaven. And as the Torah says, Vayikatz Yaakov Mishnosei, Yaakov awoke and went from sleep and he proclaimed, indeed, God is present in this place. And I did not know. He wouldn't be sleeping in that place if he knew. Vayira Vayemar, and he was frightened and he said, how awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven. So this is the gateway. This is the place that linked the earth, linked this world, this physical world, and the holy spiritual world. This teaches, says in the Medrash, This teaches us that anyone who prays in Jerusalem is considered to have prayed before the throne of God, of God's glory. For the gateway to heaven is in Jerusalem. The gates are wide open in this place for our prayers to be heard. As the passage states, this is the gate of heaven. And this is the place where the blessing comes to the rest of the world. Our sages tell us. Rabbi Nebuchadnezzar says, God's primary providence is over this land. God certainly pays attention to all countries, but his primary concern and providence is over this land. From this land, his blessing extends to the rest of the world. It is like a heart that is positioned at the center of the body because it is the source of life and it distributes its life force to all the limbs. So this is the place that connects heaven and earth. Our sages tell us that if the Goyim, if the nations of the world would have known the power of this place, the benefit, the blessings that the entire world receives through this holy place, this holy site, the Beis HaMikdash, the holy temple, when the Jews serve God in the holy temple, they would never allow this place to be destroyed. They would have been protecting the place and guarding the place with their armies. So it is the one place where we can live on earth and yet feel a heavenly sense of holiness and spirituality. A place where God whispers in our ears. The Medrash Tanchuma says, as the navel is positioned at the center of the human body, so is Israel at the center of the universe. As the passage states, those who reside upon the navel of the earth, Yoshvei al Tabor Haaretz, Israel is the center of the universe, Jerusalem is the center of Israel, the temple is the center of Jerusalem, the sanctuary is the center of the temple, and the holy ark is the center of the sanctuary. When we pray throughout the world, where do we face? We face Jerusalem. We face the land of Israel. So we're here in the west, we face east. Jews that live in the east, they face west. Jews that live in the south, they face north. When you're in Israel also, those who live in the south of Israel, of Jerusalem, they face north. Those who live in the north of Jerusalem, they face south. Those who pray in Jerusalem, they face the Holy Temple. Because this is the center of everything. But here again, the question again is why? Why Jerusalem? If Jerusalem, we just said, was the place that God chose, but God chose also Shiloh. Shiloh was a temple, a place that God chose, and he chose it, and they had the temple in Shiloh for 369 years. So why is Jerusalem so special? Yes, we learned about the whole history of that Jerusalem that didn't happen in Shiloh, but why? What if this is a place that God chose, what's the difference between the choosing of Shiloh and choosing of Jerusalem? So the Rebbe explains, that there's a big difference. There's a big difference between the choosing of Shiloh and choosing of Jerusalem. The difference says the Rebbe, is taken from the very nuances of the words that we read in this week's Torah portion. In this week's Torah portion, we read about both. Without mentioning the names, the Torah says twice about the mitzvah of bringing offerings in the place that God chooses. So the first time our sages say it refers to Shiloh, the second time it refers to Jerusalem. And however, there is a difference in the wording when God speaks about choosing Shiloh, the way God, the Torah says, it says, do not bring a place anywhere else. Unlike, I'm paraphrasing, we're going to read the text inside soon, but I just want to explain it now so we can understand it better. So he says, when talking about don't do like the other nations do, the other nations, they bring offerings everywhere, you don't do the same. Do not do the same. Bring it in the place that God has chosen. This refers to Shiloh. In other words, in Shiloh, the emphasis was, God does not want you to bring offerings in just any place. He wants a central place. So God has chosen this place, the place in Shiloh. That's where you should bring the offering, a central place where everybody brings the offering. The second time, when the Torah talks about the truth, the place that God chose, the Torah begins with, there will be a place that I choose. There, you should bring the offering. You see the difference? Let's see it inside. The first time, it talks about not bringing the offerings other places, just bring it in the place where I choose. The second time, when the Torah talks about Jerusalem, the Torah says, there will be a place that I choose. Meaning, there is a place that God chooses, not because of any offerings. That's his place. That's God's home. This is the place that God chose for him. That is the place where it creates, it connects the heaven and earth. And because of that, you should bring the offerings in that place. So let's see the readings inside. You'll see the difference. This is the first time the Torah talks about it. The Torah says as follows. Do not bring offerings in any place you choose to God. Don't do the same like the other nations do. It says only in the place that God will choose from among all your tribal regions to set his name there, you will seek his presence. There you will seek his presence. And there you may bring your burnt offerings and sacrifices. So here you see, it talks about first, don't bring it in any other place. Where should you bring it? To the place that God chooses. But when it comes the second time, which our sages tell us that this talks about Jerusalem, there the Torah changes the order. It says, bring all that I command you, your burnt offerings, and the sacrifices to the place where God, your God, will choose to establish his name. The translation also is not, if you read in the Hebrew, it says like this, V'hoya mokem asher ifcha Hashem. It will be the place that God will choose. Elokeichem bo leshaken shmo yishom. God will choose to establish his name there. Then it says, Shama taviyu eskol asher haneichem etzave eschem. There you should bring everything that I command you. Your burnt offerings and your sacrifices. And then he says, beware lest you bring your burnt offerings to any place you choose. So we see what is the focus. The focus is on the choosing in Jerusalem. This is the place that God chose. And this, let's see it how the Rebbe says it in his words. This is the Rebbe's explanation. God chose Shiloh only because the prohibition to bring offerings elsewhere. This required a dedicated location to bring our offerings. This tells us that it was not inherently holy. Rather, it was chosen for a particular reason. It was chosen for the particular reason, for the reason to bring the offerings. But Jerusalem is different. God did not choose it to provide a particular concern, to provide for a particular concern. Rather, God chose it to be his place. And since it was his place, it is only right that we bring our offerings there. He chose Shiloh for the sake of the Jews, to give them a place to bring their offerings. But he chose Jerusalem, as it were. He chose a place in which to dwell. God wanted to dwell in that city, in Jerusalem. This is why, after the destruction of the temple, after the destruction of Shiloh, there was no more holy. It wasn't a holy place. We understand why Shiloh doesn't and can't inspire the imagination of Jewish people as Jerusalem does. Shiloh served as a good purpose, but it lacks the mystical sanctity and universal centrality of Jerusalem. That's why Shiloh, like I said, once it was destroyed, it didn't have the holiness. Jerusalem remains holy. The place is holy even after the temple is destroyed. When God said, when he created the world, the purpose of creation was to establish a dira betachtonim, a home, to have a home down here in this world. The Al-Sheikh says that this refers to Yerushalayim. Of course, talking about the entire world, but it comes from and through Jerusalem, through the Beis HaMikdash, the Holy Temple in Jerusalem. The holiness of Jerusalem stays forever. As we see in Chronicles, God says to King Solomon, "And now I chose and consecrated this house so that my name will be there forever, and my eyes and heart will focus there at all times." That's the difference between Shiloh and Jerusalem. Shiloh's value today lies only in its history. This is a picture of the place in Shiloh. And they actually built a synagogue, if you can see, as you see in the picture, which resembled the temple that stood in Shiloh. As you remember, we said the temple of Shiloh was a temple of stone, but the covering was a covering of the tabernacle, the cloth covering. So they built a real roof, but they painted it to look like the covering of the tabernacle. That's in Shiloh. Jerusalem is a whole different story. Jerusalem is the one, the holy, and the eternal center of the Jewish people. It is the full gambit, the general place of God's presence. That's why even today, Jews are not allowed to walk on the place and the location, the Temple Mount. Why? Because in order to walk in the Temple Mount, we must be pure. Until the coming of Mashiach, we're not pure, when we will be sprinkled with the ashes of the red heifer. So that's why Jews are not allowed to walk in that place. But then the question is, then how come we waited so long? If Jerusalem was that place, the place where God chose to bring his place, the place of connecting heaven and earth and all these things, what we said about Jerusalem, how come when the Jews entered the land of Israel, for about 450 years, they didn't have the temple in Jerusalem. And it's not that they couldn't. They conquered the whole land with miracles. Joshua came in and they conquered the land. They conquered every part of it. Yet Jerusalem was not the place to build a temple. Why not? So the simple answer was that we wanted, but we couldn't. We wanted to build right away there, but we couldn't. Why? Not because they couldn't conquer it, but because they were not allowed to. Why not? So this is the question. If Jerusalem is so important and central to God, to our people, why didn't our ancestors establish a temple there in the first place? So the Torah tells us in Joshua, the tribe of Yehuda was unable to dislodge the Jebusites, inhabitants of Jerusalem. Why not? Not because they couldn't, but because they were not allowed. Why? Says Rashi, they were able, but they were not permitted because of the oath that Abraham had sworn to Abimelech, king of the Philistines. You see, as you remember the story with Abraham, Avraham Avinu, came to Philistine, and he came and Abimelech allowed him. After the whole story with Sarah, he then allowed him to stay and live in this place. But he wanted to make an oath with Abraham. He wanted to make a covenant. Why? Because he knew that God has promised the land to the Jewish people, to Abraham and his children. And he knew that his children will one day come and take over. So Avimelech made a covenant with Avraham, and he told him to swear that he's not going to remove his children, and his grandchildren. As we see here in Genesis, Avimelech says to Avraham, now swear by God that you will not lie to me, my children and my grandchildren. Treat me with the kindness that I showed you concerning the land in which you sojourned. Well, it took a long time until Avimelech's grandchildren passed away. Only in the time of King David, the last of the grandchildren passed away. And that's when King David was able to make his move. As Rashi says, in the days of David, the generations covered by the pledge had passed away. We're talking about what? How many years? Talking about 800 years. So the children, the grandchildren lived a very long time. Okay, however, King David, he didn't want that this should be taken by force. Although he could have just taken him away and taken it by force, King David insisted that this should be done by full purchase. Even after conquering the city, David did not proceed to build the temple. He was willing to take possession of the city by right of conquest. But he was not willing to build a temple and bring peace offerings on a land acquired through violence. That's one reason. One reason he didn't want to take by war, he didn't want to have violence on that place where the temple would be built. As it says in Samuel's, it says, Aravna asked, why did my master the king come to my home? And David replied, I came to purchase your threshing floor for the purpose of erecting an altar for God upon it. And David purchased the threshing floor and the cattle. And David erected an altar there and placed burnt offerings upon it, burnt offerings and peace offerings upon it. King David, that's one reason, as we said, that he didn't want to have bloodshed on it. There was another reason why King David wanted to purchase it. He purchased it, one place it says he purchased it for 50 shekel, another place it says he purchased it for 600 shekels. And the explanation that is given is that both is true. He collected from each tribe 50 shekel, and he purchased the whole thing with 600 shekel. And the reason why was because King David wanted to make sure that the ownership over the place of the Temple Mount should be an ownership of every single Jew, every tribe. And it should be an ownership that no one can question that ownership. When someone conquers something, then somebody else can conquer back. When you purchase this with full price, even when someone will conquer it, it is yours. The ownership is full. If you only conquer it, the ownership is not fully owned, even if nobody conquers it from you. Why? Because potentially someone can take it away. But King David didn't want this. He understood the awesomeness, the preciousness of this, the holiness of this place. And he wanted to make sure that this place belongs to the Jewish people forever. No one can take it away from them. So as the Bible tells us, King David gave full price to purchase that place, the Temple Mount. What is interesting is that there's only three places like that in Israel where the Torah tells us that it was purchased with full price. The Ma'amat HaMachpelah, the cave of the patriarchs in Hebron, the cave of the tomb of Joseph in Nablus and Shechem, and the place of the Temple Mount. And those three places are places where there's fights and they question these things. But obviously we have the proof. This is something that King David foresaw, and he wanted to make sure that it was something that is done with full ownership. And this is the reason why they didn't build the temple when they first came to Eretz Israel, because they couldn't. It was not owned fully. Why? Because of the oath that Abraham made to Avimelech, that he's not going to touch him, he's not going to touch his children and his grandchildren. But then again, the question is, why did Avram do this? Didn't Avram realize that this is the place where we want to have this holy land, the holy place? Why? There must be something more deeper to it. And here is the mystical reason. And the answer is the deeper reason why it took so long for them to get to Jerusalem. Because they were not yet ready, spiritually speaking. They were not yet ready to have Jerusalem. In order to have Jerusalem, they needed to be unified as a nation. They were unified as a nation only by King David, when he unified all of the tribes together. They became unified, and then they were able to enter the city of Jerusalem. Says the Jerusalem Talmud, Rabbi Yeshua, the son of Levi, said, it says in the Psalm, Yerushalayim, Abenuya ki'ir shechubra layachda, Jerusalem built up like a city joined together. It is a city that binds the Jewish people to each other. says the Malbim Rabbi Meir Leibish Wisser. He says, Jewish unity requires two elements. Number one, the role of Jerusalem was to unite the nations as a single body. As it is written, Jerusalem built up is like a city joined together. There the tribes ascended, etc. By making national pilgrimage to Jerusalem, all Jews facing in one direction, the particular organs of the collective coalesced into a single body. Jerusalem was thus the nation like a heart. That pumps oxygen throughout the body. And number two, the kingdom of David brought the nation into a single, unceasing rulership. As it is written, for there sat thrones of judgment, thrones for the house of David. David's kingdom was to the nation like a brain that provides awareness, intelligence, and coordination to the body. Only after King David united the nation could the temple be built in Jerusalem. This established a permanent presence for God among the people and bound the people to God. So this is the story of Jerusalem. So our ancestors did not establish the temple in Jerusalem right away because the Jewish people can only host the divine presence in a state of unity. When the Jewish people are fragmented, they're not conducive to hosting the one God. Our sages tell us that Jerusalem is a city of unity. Jerusalem comes from the word also Yira Shalem, which means completeness in fear of God. And this is our job today. Our job today is to bring, as the Tzemach Tzedek, the Rebbe, once said to a Chassid that wanted to move to Israel, he told him, Mach do Eretz Israel, make here Israel. We all waiting for the Mashiach, any day coming and taking us all out from exile, bringing us to Jerusalem. But in the meantime, our job is to make the Jerusalem in ourselves, the fear of God, the connecting to Hashem, the place, the hub that connects us to heaven and earth in ourselves. When we build our Jerusalem, this is how we build the eternal Jerusalem. And the key points from the classes we learn. Number one, Jerusalem was known to the ancients as godly, as the godly place, the nexus of heaven and earth, and the gateway through which our prayers are sent to God and God's blessing descend to us. It is a city of unity where the one God is embraced by a nation of oneness. And number two, the temple was housed in other cities before it was built in Jerusalem. But when the temple was removed from these cities, their holiness expired. Jerusalem remained a holy city. And number three, these cities cannot replace Jerusalem as the eternal Jewish capital, because the world has only one center. God chose only one place to be his home. Before, in addition to conquering Jerusalem, the Temple Mount was purchased so that its Jewish ownership could never be contested. And finally, ownership of Jerusalem does not make us arrogant and brash. It makes us humble, devoted, and responsible. It refines us and prompts us to mind our scrupulous. It enables us to transcend the pettiness of ego and embrace the infinite magnitude of divine majesty. There's beautiful stories told about Jerusalem, but I think that will be have to be done on a different occasion. Thank you all for joining, and Bezat Hashem, you know, join us for tomorrow's Tanya class, and Bezat we should be able to have Jerusalem in the real sense, in the full sense, with the coming of Mashiach.
Yes.
Thank you, Rabbi.
You're very welcome.
Thank you, Rabbi.
How are you?
Baruch Hashem, Baruch Hashem.